हेलो गाइस, दिस इज़ स्टेनो फॉर ऑल यूट्यूब चैनल। हेयर वी प्रोवाइड यू हिंदी और इंग्लिश शॉर्ट हैंड डिक्टेशंस एट डिफरेंट स्पीड। टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू प्रोवाइड यू इंग्लिश डिक्टेशन एट द स्पीड ऑफ 80, विच विल हेल्प यू इन वेरियस स्टेनो स्किल टेस्ट्स। गेट रेडी फॉर 80 वर्ड पर मिनट शॉर्ट हैंड डिक्टेशन। स्टार्ट। On August 15, Nepal Prime Minister K.P. Sharma Oli made a friendly gesture towards India by telephoning Prime Minister Narendra Modi to convey greetings on India's Independence Day. This should be welcomed. This was followed by a meeting of the India-Nepal Joint Project Monitoring Committee on August 17, chaired by the Indian Ambassador to Nepal and the Nepal Foreign Secretary. The committee was set up to review progress in the large number of bilateral cooperation projects. An India-Nepal Joint Commission meeting at the level of foreign ministers is due later in October but may be held virtually due to the novel coronavirus pandemic. But will the two sides hold foreign secretary level talks on the vexed boundary issue that is related to Kalapani and Sustha? Unilateral actions. The Nepali side has upset the apple cart by taking a series of unilateral actions. A relatively minor dispute involving about 35 square kilometers of territory around the Kalapani Springs was expanded to claim a large wedge of Indian territory towards the east, measuring nearly 400 square kilometers. The expanded claim was incorporated into Nepal through a constitutional amendment and a revised official map. India has been confronted with a fait accompli, though Nepal has conveyed its willingness to negotiate on the issue in foreign secretary level talks. India should be willing to engage in talks with Nepal on all aspects of India-Nepal relations. But any talks on the Kalapani issue should be limited to the area which was the original subject for negotiations and Sustha. To agree to talks which include the unilateral changes will create a very bad precedent not only in India-Nepal relations but in managing India's borders in general. This is irrespective of Nepal presenting historical documents or maps which support its claims. Borders which have been accepted by both sides for more than 100 years and which have also been reflected on their official maps cannot be unilaterally altered by one side coming up with archival material which has surfaced in the meantime. This would make national boundaries unstable and shifting and create avoidable controversies between countries, as is the case now between India and Nepal. Geography and boundaries. The Treaty of Sugauli of 1816 sets the Kali River as the boundary between the two countries in the western sector. There was no map attached to the treaty. Nepal is now claiming that the main tributary of the Kalapani River rises east of the Lipu Lake Pass from the Limpiadhura रिज लाइन एंड हैंज शुड सर्व एज द बॉर्डर इवन इफ द लेंथियस्ट ट्रिब्यूटरी मे बी वन प्रिंसिपल फॉर अ रिवर लाइन बाउंड्री विच इज इट सेल्फ डिबेटेबल इट इज नॉट द ओनली वन देयर आर मैनी बाउंड्रीज विच डू नॉट फॉलो एनी geographical principle at all but are the result of historical circumstances mutual agreement and legal recognition the fact is that once the British side carried out detailed surveys of the region they consistently showed the India-Nepal border heading due north of Kalapani Springs to a few kilometers east of the Lipu Lake Pass. This alignment never changed in subsequent years and was also reflected in Nepali official maps. This is just a fact. It has been argued that it was the East India Company and successor governments which engaged in cartographic chicanery to shift the source of the Kali River towards the east. What prevented successive Nepali governments to reject such chicanery and assert the Nepali claim? There is no record of such a claim being raised at any point including when the company was in a generous mood having received Nepali help in putting down the 1857 Indian War of Independence. In 1969, the then Prime Minister of Nepal, Kirti Nidhi Bist, demanded that India military personnel manning 17 villages along the Nepal-Tibet border since the early 1950s be withdrawn. Here is the National Panchayat record of Bist's statement. The minister informed that the check posts manned by the Indian nationals exist in 17 villages. Gumsha, Mustang, Namche Bazar, Lama Bagar, Kodari Thula, Thumshe Thulo, Olanchung Dola, Mugu, Simikot, Tinkar, Shipua, Jhumshang, Pushu, Basua, and Selubesh. If Lipu Lake and Kalapani were on Nepali territory, then why were they omitted from the list? I have pointed out earlier that the argument that the omission was due to Nepali magnanimity taking into account India's security concerns vis-a-vis China is laughable. The withdrawal of Indian military personnel from the Nepal-Tibet border was precisely to win brownie points with China. The inconvenient fact is that the Chinese, at least since 1954, have accepted Lipu Lake Pass as being in Indian territory. In the Nepal-China boundary agreement of 1960, the starting point of the boundary is clearly designated at a point just west of the Tinkar Pass. History and ties in a recent article, The Hindu editorial page, August 19, 2020, Nepali journalist Kanak Mani Dikshit advised Indians must try and understand why Nepal does not have an Independence Day, the implication.